Welcome back to Morning Express. Glad you're staying with us on this fine hour. It is now time for Person of Interest. But before we get to that, just a reminder of our question of the day where we're asking you, do you think that the ODM disciplinary measures will curb violence in the party? Do you think the ODM disciplinary measures will curb violence in the party? That is our question of the day. Do continue giving us your thoughts and comments. Many of them already coming in here. Simon Baraza says, no, political parties really have no capacity to prevent the violence. The police force should come out more strongly about this. So do keep your thoughts and comments coming in. We'll be sampling more of them as we go by. But for now, it is time for Person of Interest. And as we had promised earlier, we were going to have the Kisumu gubernatorial aspirant, Hezron Makobewa, but he will not be able to make it to our studios this morning, so we do apologize for that. But Mike Gitonga still has a person of interest for us this morning. Mike.
Thank you very much, Michelle. And yes, an apology there. So we are now going to have Oscar Omoke, who is an aspiring member of parliament for Langata constituency, and joining us this morning as our person of interest. Good morning, and thank you for joining us. So, Oscar, this is your first attempt at going for Member of Parliament in Langata.
Yes.
Why do you think you fit the bill?
I was born and bred up in Langata constituency, particularly at Nairobi West. That's where I grew up with. Yes. So, as I grew up in Langata, I have seen Langata grow, I've seen Langata change, and I think that as a person, been in the life of politics, and I've decided to run for the parliamentary seat of Langata because I think I understand the dynamics, I understand the challenges of Langata constituency.
I'm sure there are very many people who live in Langata and have grown up in Langata and possibly would say they understand. So what makes you think you can deliver?
My background, actually, to where I have come from right now is that in my upbringing has been in Langata. And I went to Madaraka Primary School. I'm a graduate of political science from Maseno University. And for the last 15 years, I've actually been working. I was at National Hospital Insurance Fund for 15 years. My passion and actually my belief is that in Langata constituency, I have seen a gap and I've seen a space whereby I can feel and represent the people of Langata, not just because I was born
And bred there.
Yes, but because I've seen the challenges, and I think I understand the challenges better than those who are actually.
All right, let's talk a little bit about your upbringing, and maybe we've said you went to Madaraka Primary School, you grew up there, and what is it from your past that you think would equip you today to be able to lead the people of Langata to a better, or rather to be a member of parliament for Langata?
When I was growing up, at age of 12 years, I lost my mother. And I was actually brought up with my father alone. I'm a second born of 8 children. And from that point, we took charge when we were very young children. And we saw that as we grow up, we can and we must actually take charge of ourselves. That is when I realized that leadership does not really need someone to be taught or someone to be, basically for me, it has come through out of experience. I grew up as a child, and in our upbringing, you could see it was a closed society whereby any parents could come to you and discipline those young men around there. When I went to Maseno University, I was elected a student leader at second year. And for second, third, and fourth year, I was a student leader of Maseno University. When I joined National Hospital Insurance Fund, I was elected the chairman of the National Hospital Insurance Fund, SACO. So my leadership is actually from my background, and I have the passion for leadership, and that's why actually I have decided to leave the formal sector, which is NHIF, to join politics.
Okay, and when you look at the incumbent, that's Joash Olum. How would you score his performance so far?
On a scale of 1 to 10, I can stagger it between 2 and 3.
Wow, that's a very, very low score.
Yes.
Why do you give him such a low score?
You see the role of a member of parliament is basically representation, mm-hmm. legislation, mm-hmm. and oversight. And when I look at those three basic pillars of Member of Parliament, I have not seen any bill fronted mm-hmm. or any arguments advanced in Parliament in terms of representation by the current Member of Parliament. Mm-hmm. In terms of oversight, when I look at his performance at the Constituency Development Fund, the constituents and actually most of those who think that the Member of Parliament should have done much better than what he has done, and when I look at his contribution as a member of an oversight body, he was actually representing the Orange Democratic Movement at these committees of Parliament. ODM actually removed him because I think and I believe it was because of his not being effective in those committees. So in all those three parameters, I don't see where he can score. And that's why I give him that skill.
Wow. Okay. Mm. So what is it that you would do differently as Omoke that, you know, is going to move from three of what you've given him to maybe, I don't know what you're expecting to, what your performance is expected to be?
As I said, if you look at the three pillars of being a member of parliament, one is actually representation.
Correct.
And when you are supposed to represent a society or a community, then you are someone who must understand what the society and the community actually stands for, what they believe in, and what they actually want you to advance in parliament. As a young person, I believe that the cosmopolitan of the Nairobi politics is basically cosmopolitan. And majority of the voters currently are actually young people. Our issues are different from the issues of the current Member of Parliament. Whatever I go through, I have a family, I have small children going to school, I have...
Are you suggesting that he's possibly out of touch because of his age with what is happening?
Not necessarily. Mm. Also, someone's background determines someone's performance. If I have looked at his background, I've looked at what he has done previously, and I have not seen an author of any leadership position where he has held. And I think that one also has eaten into his performance as a Member of Parliament.
Okay, so how is your background going to influence what you have to do? I know you've mentioned that you've lived in Langata, but like I said, I'm sure there are many people who've lived in Langata and possibly would feel they also qualify.
Yes.
The fact that you've lived there and grown up there does not mean that you can actually now, you know, become a leader. So what is it in your background that you can pick and say, this is what is going to make me a good Member of Parliament for Langata, for the people of Langata?
First of all, I say that I was born in Langata.
Correct.
And in that society where you are being brought up, you mingle with different persons from different regions within the country. And as you grow up, my upbringing, we did not segment or think someone comes from here, someone comes from here, because we were all born and bred and we grew up together. That background actually informs someone's approach and someone's intermingling mm-hmm. with the society. And I've told you that leadership, for me, I have experienced and I have seen right from the university, right from the high school, what one is required to do as a leader. So I basically believe that at this tender age, when you have actually done some small experience on leadership, you have been entrusted by various people, right from the university to where I used to work, that trust, if I did not break it, actually I believe I can actually translate it to be and represent the people of Langata.
Okay, so now if you're going to represent the people of Langata, and like you've rightly said, you've grown up there, you've lived there, what are some of the things that the people of Langata are need change? What are some of the things that they can highlight and say, in Langata, if this was changed, this would really make a difference?
One very basic and fundamental requirement of the people of Langata is actually representation. If you look at the current leadership, the legislative leadership of Langata, you will realize that we feel not represented. We are not heard as Langata. We cannot see our person actually articulating and telling the world what Langata is going through, what is happening. And Langata has very many challenges, right from the issues of the Langata Primary School, the current land saga, and we believe that as a leader of Langata, someone, him, he should have actually put his voice.
And that is true. Yes. That is what he should have done. But now the question is, what are those things that you are going to stand in Parliament, should you become the Member of Parliament of Langata, and say, these are key issues for my people?
Now, one of the key issues for Langata, because you understand Langata is basically, it starts from the South Sea area to Madaraka, to Nyayo High Rise, to the Mugumoine ward, then to Karen. Langata is such a diverse constituency, right from, if you look at the people of Karen, the issues are different from the people in Raila village down there. It's different from the people of South Sea. All of them have their different challenges, because I'll tell you for a fact that the issues of South Sea are different from the issues of the Karen area, and they're different from the issues of the slum area. One thing that I really want to focus on is the issue of unemployment and security in Langata. Many of our children, many of the people from the slum area have actually lost their lives just because of maybe insecurity, lack of employment, and all that. I believe that Langata constituency is one of the most resourceful constituencies in Nairobi. It is a constituency whereby you will find a lot of government institutions, you'll find a lot of NGOs working there, you'll find a lot of the private sector working there. We need to partner and ensure that those young people who are actually jobless in Langata, those people who are actually engaging in drugs, in crimes, have space, have been actually been given an opportunity by the local institutions to ensure that they're employed so that we reduce the issues of insecurity. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, so the priority for you would be unemployment. Now, would you be looking at creating employment within Langata constituency, or are you looking at the national government to create those jobs and hopefully they filter and get to the people of Langata and that, you know, alleviates that issue? Would you be looking at a local way of solving this problem or a national?
As a member of parliament, first of all, I want to focus on my jurisdiction. And I'm sure that as a member of parliament, I can actually knock into doors in Langata, speak to the CEOs, speak to the NGOs, and ensure that those young men are actually encouraged to maybe pursue a career path or get employment. But as a member of parliament, again, you are a national leader. And we have exposures and we have opportunities out of Langata. I will want also to encourage those of my voters in Langata to maybe if you have opportunities outside, I will endeavor to ensure that they are also considered. So it is two-pronged, one internally and secondly out of Langata.
All right, and this is just a reminder for those of you who are watching from wherever you may be, you have an opportunity to also chip in with your questions. You can do that via Twitter, or you can also call us directly in studio. We'll open up the phone lines, and especially the people of Langata, if he would make it to be, or if Oscar Omoke would make it to be the Member of Parliament, do you think he articulates the problems that you have, and do you feel that he would represent you well? And maybe you have questions that you'd like to ask him. The phone lines are now going to be open so that you can do that. Now, Oscar, you are seeking this Member of Parliament seat on an ODM ticket.
Right.
Okay. And maybe just first of all to find out from you what your comments are regarding some of the violence that we have seen within ODM party.
As a member of a party, of the party, on the Orange Democratic Movement, and I've been a member for the last 15 or so years, what we believe in is democracy is a noble process, and violence is not part of a democratic process. So as ODM and as Oscar, I don't encourage violence, and I do, as a party, I believe that the party leader and the party leadership does not encourage violence. So as a member whom I actually subscribe to that, I don't believe in
violence. We've seen quite a number of the top ODM leaders basically being questioned in regards to violence. Does that, you know, sort of send a message that if at the top there are problems in regards to violence and just handling matters, how much can we trust the party?
When you mention the top and I'm sure you are insinuating the deputy party leader, the governors involved, the senators involved.
And those are top brass when it comes to the party. They're leaders of the party.
Those are top brass leaders. Yes. But what we must also understand is that they were going for a political rally. And the cause and the source of the violence is actually what we should address. Why should they be attacked? Who did the attack? Because I did not see them actually propagating violence. I saw them running away and protecting themselves from hooligans or some people who are actually attacking them.
Okay.
So I don't believe that the party leadership is actually tolerating.
No, but when you look at a case like what happened with Ali Hassan Joho in Western, we have a governor who came in, basically had been advised not to come in, but he went against the advice of the police or the government or whoever it is that had, you know, there was also within the party those who had advised that he should not come in because there's a bit of tension.
Yes.
But he still, regardless, came in and said one of the reasons why he was coming in is because he was not informed that that was going to be taking place. Is it his position to be informed?
I don't believe so, because you previously asked the party leadership. Governors are part of the party leadership, but I want to actually move that away from the party leadership and put it as an individual, because I don't believe that my friend and actually my political mentor, Professor Anyang' Nyong'o or Ali Hassan Joho, have the time to prepare and incite people to violence.
Okay. I mean, and Oscar, that is what we were asking our viewers this morning, whether the ODM disciplinary measures will be able to curb violence in the party. And a lot of comments coming in on social media. Julius Njuguna says, this is a PR activity. Take this to the bank. No one will be fined more than 100,000 shillings. Patrick says, violence has always been an ODM trademark. Who was disciplined after the Men in Black? And Muammar here says, no, it does not have any credibility of stopping pre-election violence. And that's just what people are saying on our phone lines. But let's also take a few calls from members and residents of Lang'ata constituency. We have Bernard on the line. Bernard, good morning. Many thanks for calling in. What's your question or comment?
Thank you very much. To start with is that, one, I'm also an aspiring, MCA Kigetusu. Mm-hmm. And I think Omoke is a leader, is a man of the people, and he has been working with us since I lived around Lang'ata constituency. Mm-hmm. He has been in the front line of making us at least to see the ability of leadership. One, to start with, the man has been with us here in Otiende area. We've been seeing how he conducts himself. I've also been, he has been my mentor, anyway, through his action.
All right, Bernard, just before we continue, can you please switch off your TV or probably lower the volume?
Okay. Now, what I'm saying...
All right, go ahead.
Yes. What I'm trying to say is that Otiende, he has been in the front line of expressing his interest of leadership through what he has been showing us.
Mm-hmm.
One, he has been contributing on 1, 2, 3 issues, which I cannot be able to mention because of 1, 2, 3 reasons. Two, Otiende, Mr. Omoke is a man of his own integrity.
Mm-hmm.
As for what we've been seeing, right from school, although we cannot be able to charge because most of us we have been doing right things, but when we come in leadership, we change. But Otiende, at our area of Lang'ata, I think Omoke, with his experience of leadership, he can make it.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, I've heard you talking of the rule of the committee of ODM, whether it can be in a position of achieving to discipline or take action on the people who went against the laws, the laws and regulations of the party.
Right.
One, what I can say is that the party has its own mandate of disciplining their members.
Mm-hmm.
Two, the party has power to dismiss all to do to take the necessary measures over these people. Mm-hmm. So what I can say is that the party has its mandate. Let nobody intimidate the rule and the rule and regression of the party. That is why these people. That's why we have a panel. Nobody has power to differ each other than the party's law of discipline and measures.
All right. All right. Thank you very much. That is Bernard calling in from Lang'ata constituency. He is also an aspirant, saying that Omoke has been very active in development projects there. But let's also take another call. Jakuru is also an MCA aspirant, Lang'ata constituency. Jakuru, good morning. Many thanks for calling in to Morning Express. To your comment or question.
Yes, my name is Jakuru. I'm also aspirant for UDEM Lang'ata. Mugumoine ward.
Right.
I would like to ask the aspirants. Lang'ata, we have a lot of issue of water. Number two, we have a lot of issue of cemetery. Number three, the Lang'ata, it has been treated like a ODM zone or opposition zone. That's why we have not development. How is he going to do about it? Because Lang'ata people are suffering because it's an opposition zone. And this time, Lang'ata people, they are not going to vote somebody who is not resident for Lang'ata, and they are tired of leadership being within the opposition area.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Many thanks, Jakuru, there, aspiring MCA Lang'ata constituency. Many thanks for calling in. And the callers are raising some very pertinent questions. But what I find interesting is the latest caller, Jakuru, here, saying that Lang'ata constituency, the people of Lang'ata have seen no development because it is an ODM zone. Michael, I think that is a big cause for concern. I mean, Oscar, should an area really be marginalized and have no development because it is an opposition stronghold?
But then again, it is an allegation. So maybe first of all to hear if indeed that is the case.
I don't think Lang'ata is an opposition zone.
Mm-hmm.
For the last 3 years, we can say it has been an opposition zone. But the former member of parliament, the Right Honorable Raila Amolo Odinga, was a member of parliament for Lang'ata for some times. And for a stint of it, he was a prime minister.
Mm-hmm.
So we cannot exclusively say that it is an opposition zone. But I understand what the caller is saying, that for a longer period of time, His Excellency, the prime minister, has actually been perceived to be the opposition. But that does not actually mean that Lang'ata constituency has all these problems because it's an opposition zone. Lang'ata is a cosmopolitan area. Lang'ata is an area where we have not only, because when you say opposition, it means that majority are in opposition.
Mm.
But it's a zone where I'm sure very many national leaders, county leaders, stay around. It can be termed opposition because of the representation. But I don't fully believe it's an opposition. I can tell you for a fact, Lang'ata, all the members of the county assembly are in ODM.
Mm-hmm.
The member of parliament is in ODM. The county governor is in ODM.
Mm-hmm.
So it is only the member of parliament whom can be termed to be in the opposition.
Right. I mean, and Jakuru also raises other issues in terms of what's ailing Lang'ata constituency. The issue of water is something that the residents of Lang'ata have dealt with for quite a long time. The cemetery is also another issue. But before you also answer to that, let's take another caller. We have Simon calling in from Lang'ata. Simon, good morning. Salma, I beg your pardon. Salma, how are you? Good morning. What's your comment or question?
Good morning. How are you?
Go ahead.
Mine is just a congratulations to Honorable Oscar Omoke.
Mm-hmm.
He's really done well. And as a young leader, we are really looking forward to his leadership. We encourage him to accommodate us as the youth and to work with everyone on board. But so far, we have seen his leadership, and if Lang'ata can invest in such a personality, then I don't think we will lack anything in Lang'ata.
Right.
That's all.
Okay, and Omoke seems to have some supporters. There is Salma calling in from Lang'ata. We also have Stanley, who's calling in from Busia. Stanley, what's your question or comment?
Yes, thank you, madam.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to actually give thumbs up to Mr. Omoke Oscar.
Go ahead.
My comment is that Omoke is my college mate from Maseno, and I'm really congratulating him that he goes for that particular seat. I'm happy about it because he led us through during that academic year, and quite a number of issues, actually, he managed to solve them as a leader of the Students' Union. How I encourage most of my young members of this particular country to go for those elective posts. Thank you so much. Congratulations. Go on. We are behind you.
All right, that is Stanley. Thank you for calling in, Stanley, there from Busia. And you seem to have been a student leader in university as well, Omoke.
Yes, I was the chairman of the student union for three, actually, consecutive terms, from second year to fourth year. And that transcends to having a lot of people who are in Maseno knows me by name during our years.
All right, Mr. Omoke, now something that Jakuru brought up, and this is the issue of water. And I just want to hear from you whether, since the promulgation of the Constitution 2010, do Kenyans understand the role of a member of parliament? Because we're coming from, we were coming from a regime where a member of parliament literally took care or was seen to be responsible for taking care of everything. Have you done as a leader, a good job of articulating what is the role of a member of parliament? And maybe you can redefine what that role is.
I think to many members of our society is that we are still, it is a process that has to be, we have to take the society through. Because upon the new constitution coming into effect, many of them are still at, as you say, they believe that a member of parliament is responsible for all that's supposed to be happening. But we have been trying to explain to them, albeit not with a lot of ease, that we need to differentiate the role of the county government and the national government. And the role of member of parliament, as I told you, legislation, oversight, and representation. As much as the issue of water, I know it is largely a county government function, where Langata we have different ward representatives who sit actually, and actually one of the current MCAs actually chairs the water committee, water and sanitation committee at the county assembly of Nairobi. It's a bit difficult to convince the populace that actually the person who can actually resolve easily the water issues is from the county assembly. But as a member of parliament, we will not run away from that because our constituents, when there are issues of water, we must liaise and we must go to the county government and tell them this is where the issue is. So we must have a synergy whereby the national assembly member and the county assembly members work together.
Working together.
Now, that is what actually has lacked in Langata, because I'm sure that if one of the biggest issues, which is water, and the people of Langata, most of them might not know that the MCA there chairs the water board. Then those issues, if they work together, we could have actually solved the issue.
Okay, we'll come back to you on that and maybe just giving direction on how they need to work together, because I'm sure there are a number of organizations within Langata that have come up together to, like Neighborhood Watch, and try and push that, but that has not happened. So let's take a call from Bernard, calling from Langata. Good morning, Bernard, to your comment or question.
Good morning.
Yes, go right ahead.
First, I would like to thank Honorable Oscar. He's quite, I think, bringing out issues on Langata, which is quite good.
Okay.
I have one question for him. I'm calling from Nairobi West. There have been allegations and issues around him and party loyalty, that he runs an ODM ticket, campaign on ODM ticket, but on the other hand, has a lot of close relationship with the Jubilee Party, getting support from them in terms of resource for campaign. And of course, these things have come up in Langata, but have not been addressed. So I wanted you just to clarify his close relationship with Jubilee Party.
All right. Thank you for your question, Bernard. And, well, do you want to answer that directly to Bernard?
Yes, I need to address that to Bernard, because allegations are allegations. First of all, you need to find out where they are coming from and whose interests they are serving. I have been an ODM party member for all this time. when I was in the civil service, I was in ODM. The party knows me by name. Mm-hmm. I've worked for the party and I've done a lot with the party. When you hear that Oscar is running for Member of Parliament, then maybe one or two of your opponents decide that they're feeling the heat, so they have to look for something and put it on your head.
So you think this is it's propaganda?
Substantiation is very important. Someone needs to substantiate. When you say that he's associated with maybe Jubilee Party, is it mm-hmm. because he was working for NHIF, or has he been seen meeting Jubilee Party, or something? You cannot just allegate. Give an allegation. You must say we think because we suspect we have seen him doing this. Something must actually follow you.
So you are in ODM party, and those are just pure propaganda. What is your statement to Bernard?
They should treat that as opponent campaign propaganda.
Okay. Yeah. All right, coming back to the issue of water. Yeah. And this, of course, is one of those things that it's a basic commodity. As a leader or an aspiring leader of this country, because when you're sitting in the National Assembly, you really are a national leader.
Yeah.
How is that problem going to be solved, not just in Langata, but in Nairobi? It is a basic commodity. When it rains, help us understand that, you know, there's the logic that, you know, we have floods. Then 2-3 months later, we are complaining that we do not have enough water. Our electricity goes up because we're using the geothermal electricity, and we have no water running on our taps. How is that going to be solved from a national leader perspective?
We all know where Nairobi served the dams that actually feed Nairobi with water. And there's always been an argument that the dams belongs to another county, then the Nairobi County needs to subsidize their income and all that. But at a national level, I believe that to solve the water issue, it should not only be left to the county or just the county government. I think we have the national water policy. We have a department in government that actually deals with water, the national water and pipeline. And I think that as a national leader, we need to actually find out what is the cause, what is the source of the problem. Because the problem cannot just be that rain comes, we see the floods, then shortly we have dry taps. We need to understand, do we have sufficient water harvesting, water storage facility? How do we tell our people? Have we taken time as a government to actually educate our people on the use of water? Because the use of water, it can be assumed that it is natural, that you will take a bath, you will wash your car, and it does not really need in education. But I believe that even the way we use water mm-hmm. is important. We need to come up with policies, we need to come up with these issues whereby we can train our people and tell them, when you waste even a drop of water, it affects the future
The future use. All right, let's take a call from Obiero calling from Kibra. Good morning, Obiero. Thank you for calling, and to your question or comment. Obiero.
Good morning.
Morning.
Yes, my name is Obiero. I'm from Kibra.
Okay.
Yes, first of all, I would like to congratulate the one who is now in the media.
Omoke.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Only one thing which I would like to ask him, issue concerning the handout, mm-hmm. where you find that many people normally depend on handout and whatever. What can he tell young men concerning what we call handout? Again, I really disagree with the one who said that Kibra is for, maybe Langata is for the opposition.
Mm-hmm.
What we have seen, that there is a lot of propaganda which has been propagated in Langata concerning His Excellency, the Prime Minister, Raila Amolo Odinga. So what can he help, or what he can tell us concerning the propaganda which has been propagated with those people? Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Obiero in Kibra. Keep your calls coming. Keep your comments coming via social media. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, we continue with person of interest, Oscar Omoke, who's an aspiring member of parliament for Langata. We'll take a short break. We'll be right back.